There are a number of defoliators affecting the noni, which you see caterpillar, grasshoppers, and scrapers, and so on. And there is also a stem griddler in the noni. Some of the beetles, just like a ring, they cut, and this leads to breaking away of the stem. And some of the sucking pests, which are the lace wing bugs, which is one of the biggest menace in nurseries and even in grown crops, fruit flies. Yesterday, Dr. Siddhanandam was presenting information on fruit flies and its role. Then mealybug, green, this is one of the major problems, green scales are also another problem. And some of the important diseases, the alternaria and anthracnose. For the first time, this was from World Noni Research Foundation, the first record was made due to alternaria and colitotrichum. And also, you see some of the viral problem also. And the fruit rot is yet another problem, both dry and soft rots. This also has been recorded for the first time, and the causative agents were identified in the previous projects. And the fruit rot pathogen affects the fruits as well as the stem, and whereas the soft rot caused by a bacterial pathogen also a serious problem, and sooty mold is yet another one, both affecting the fruits as well as the leaves. Then the root and stem problems. So nematode is one of the major problem, which was highlighted earlier also. This is the root knot nematode female, which lays eggs and causes greater damage. This is a fungal problem, a root rot. The entire crop gets killed due to its onslaught. Okay, so this gives an idea what are all the pests and diseases prevalent in the noni crop. This was possible because of the project funded by World Noni Research Foundation. Our earlier principal investigators made very extensive survey, and they have recorded all these things. And the thing is, we have been normally, as a plant protection scientist, there is a routine way of doing it. That is one aspect. Sometimes we look differently, the same thing. This is only a reinstatement of earlier things. So we say about indigenous technology, whether we are looking deeply into those things, whether there is a science behind it, such type of things we would like to discuss. So whether we should see whether we have exhausted all the options. I would say we are not exhausted. There are ways. See, there should be a synergy between protection and production technology, which many a time doesn't happen, either due to incompatibility of the scientist or other reasons. The synergy is not existing. There should be, each one should be complementary. Both production and protection technology should be complementary, and they should be compatible. Trying to understand the production technologies which are complementary to pest control strategies. There are several production technologies complementing the pest and disease management. And look into the plant ecology, soil ecology, and the environment. These are all nothing new, but I am trying to reinstate all these things. Suppose we are interested in the overall productivity of the crop. That's our group, whether he is a plant protection scientist or a production scientist or an agronomist or horticulturist, whatever it is. Ultimately, we aim for the production. So there are several options which normally farmers practice or earlier practices. See, one is the organic. Since we know that noni should be grown under organic cultivation, see, organic is one of the major inputs. So it may be organic cake or a compost or a vermicompost or even decomposed coconut coir peat. This is one of the major media which could be exploited for pest and disease management. It can be an enriched organics also. So many a time it's a common practice in our farm also to add farmyard manure along with other biological agents. Keep it for some time, enrich it, allow the multiplication of various antagonists, any bio agents, and then apply. So So that's another approach. Then mulching. One morning, Dr. Ratna was presenting mulching. So mulching, what is the effect on, of course, we mulch for the crop to save water. There are other aspects which we have to look into it deeply. Likewise, weeding and farm hygiene. And again, it has an impact on the plant protection. Then intercropping, it may be allelopathy and cover crop. Both in intercrop and cover crop, the allelopathic aspects has to be looked into deeply. Then trap crop, biological control agents, suppressive soils. So these are all some of the areas where we can look deeply and develop a synergic technology, which will also coincide or compatible with the production technology. We will see one by one. What is really a suppressive soil? See, they are characterized by a very low level of disease development, even though a virulent pathogen and a susceptible host exist. See, everybody knows all the three conditions. See, the plant must be susceptible, environment should be conducive, and pathogen should be virulent. Then the disease onset is there. But in spite of it, the plant is not affected. So what is the reason? The first example was the take-all disease of wheat. And the continuous monocropping was there, and to our surprise, there was no disease at all after some time. Normally, what we expect, continuous cropping will lead to more multiplication of pathogen and there is more disease incident. But it was the reverse of the case. The scientists looked into it and found that a particular microorganism, Pseudomonas, was very predominant. And because of it, the disease was able to be suppressed. And like that, biotic and abiotic elements in the soil, it may be a pH or any other factor like water requirement and so on, the environment also contribute to the suppressiveness. But most defined system have identified biological elements as the primary factors as disease suppressing agents. The classical examples, as I told you, it is take-all disease. So what are the abiotic condition may be the structure of the soil, or it may be moisture or pH. Then biotic condition like soil, you know that it's actually a living medium. The lot of microbes are there. So what do? They can compete or parasitize the existing pathogen, or it can antagonize, or it may compete for nutrition. There are several ways. These are all common. But only thing, what kind of things are going on in the environment that we should understand. And soil, as we know, they have enormous diversity of beneficial microbes or any other organism. Can we increase them or induce them and make the soil more suppressive? That is one idea we can think of. The use of beneficial microbes, whether we can increase. So looking for the potential microbes, then should have rhizosphere competence. See, it is not merely when we see a petri dish, we have antagonistic things and zones are there. Immediately we jump to a conclusion that is more antagonistic, effective against this particular pathogen. But it grows in a different environment. When we multiply and put it in the soil, what really it happens? How it works? How it survives? How long it survives? Whether it is able to survive for a short period or a long period? See, disease may occur any time. Different kind of disease, starting from seed down to harvest. We have number of diseases. But this particular organism which we are trying to introduce must also survive. The rhizosphere competence should exist because it has to compete with the several other organisms. It may be beneficial or any other organisms. So these details you must be able to generate and sustain its population throughout the life cycle of plants. That is very important. That's why in many cases, sometimes in the field level experiments, sometimes we fail to control. Of course, there are several other external factors like quality and so on and so forth. There should be a multiple producers of antibiotics. So several organisms, Dr. Madhivanan also now working to find out whether the organism which he identifies has more than one antibiotic so that it can prevent the growth of either a fungus or a bacterium or sometimes a nematode also. So when we look into the microbial community as such, it may be responsible for induced systemic resistance, or it may be an antifungal protein, or it may be a volatile antibiotics or non-volatile antibiotics, or there may be competition. These are some of the areas. Of course, now many people are working into that deeply, and so that we can develop a strategy. See, for example, the organic cakes, neem cake we use, that we know traditionally that we use neem cake for controlling nematodes and so many other things. The brassica cakes, the oil seed extracted from the brassica group of plants is very effective. I will tell you in the subsequent slides. Likewise, the decomposed coir pith. See, coir pith as such, you know what is a coir pith? It is a byproduct after making a rope. Dr. Ratnam will be aware that how the decomposed, coir pith, how it contaminates and pollute the environment in southern parts of our country and wherever coconut is being raised. Then vermicompost. Every day we talk about it. Then what is the effect of these things on pest or disease or any other biotic agent which causes damage? Then animal waste like fish meal and meal. So many wastes are being there. But whether we are able to use it effectively for the management of the crop, including plant protection. See, vermicompost, we know that it's the product of interaction between earthworms and the microorganisms. Not earthworm alone is doing the job. Microorganisms are also involved in the mesophilic degradation of organic waste. So there is a plant growth promotion, we know, and the earthworm casing greatly increase the microbial population that produce the plant growth hormones. So that's responsible for the plant growth and which becomes absorbed on the humates produced during the vermicompost process. So both way it is helpful. And disease suppression, the soil-borne pathogens are suppressed due to vermicompost application, mainly due to microbial antagonism. That is one of the thing. The nematode suppression has also been found out. Increase in nematophagous fungi. There are fungus which can trap or parasitize or kill. They are called a nematophagous fungi, nematode trapping fungi. It will simply trap and it will not kill. It will not allow the fungus to infect the roots. So what is happening after vermicompost application? So these are all some areas. Is there any other mechanism so that our technology will be more foolproof? Then the pests are also suppressed. See, sometimes, many a times, as a pathologist, I take only the observation on pest diseases. As an entomologist, you'll take observation on pests. Now there is a good synergy between entomology and pathology from our own group, and both the projects are working together to develop a synergistic technology to manage both pest and disease. See, for example, in vermicompost application, aphids, mealybugs, spider mites, and leaf-eating caterpillars were supposed to be reduced, which normally we miss to observe. So we have to be critical in observing all these things. Then decomposed coir pith. Coir pith, we made a small experiment when I was working in Forest College. See, it's an effective medium. It can be. Normally, coir pith is being exported to several countries for various purposes, for growing plants and other things. The decomposed coir, how do we decompose? It takes 1 year for complete decomposition. See, we know that a good organic manure should have a narrow carbon ratio, 1:18 or so. If the carbon-nitrogen ratio is wider, it is not good for application. It will not serve as a manure for the crop. We know that. But when we use the decomposed coir pith, that is by pleurotus fungi, it gets decomposed within a month, and it can suppress several soil-borne pathogens. We found out that many of the forest seedlings, which are affected by root rot pathogens, they are very much reduced. The growth is also very vigorous. We found that some of the phenolics found in the decomposed coir pith is able to suppress. It is helpful, and also it gives a vigorous growth. So we should also find out whether what happens to noni also. So you know, this is one of the best medium to grow noni seedlings. Whether we can free the noni seedlings from nematode or any other infestation, that we have to generate data on these things. See, actually, now recently a concept, they say biofumigation. It's not nothing new, only the word is new. And already we apply neem cakes or any other cake, brassica cake, especially the glucosinolates present, it's a group of compound present in the brassica plants. When you make cake out of it, they are very toxic to soil-borne pathogen, because on hydrolysis, isothiocyanates are released. We know that isothiocyanate is a toxic. Thiocyanates are very toxic. This particular compound is very toxic to many of the microbes, both beneficial as well as useful organisms. I'm sorry, harmful. So we have to carefully look how this works against our disease-causing or any other organisms. See, other phytochemicals like phenols, ascorbic acid may also complement the activity of this GCLS, that is glucosinolates. And these two species, Brassica gentia and Raphanus sativus, are used as green manure, may be effective against soil-borne pathogen. It has been reported in the literature. So when we look for an intercrop or a mixed crop, what kind of things? Of course, we look for the harvested produce, whether it is economical, whether this tree gives more yield or the intercrop gives more yield. But we have to also look into the other aspects, whether it is useful to manage the other biotic stresses. That is also, we have to, many a time we miss that. Groups of compounds from Brassica. Of course, these are all some of the group of chemicals they have isolated, and they are detrimental to the pathogens. So mulching is another practice which we normally use and recommend just to save water. But we use different mulches also. But what happens? Mulches doesn't remain as such. As time passes on, it decomposes. It is because of the microorganism. After decomposition, what happens? Whether it is going to be useful for the main crop, or it is going to be more favorable to pathogen, or it is going to be a suppressive one, such kind of data are really lacking. So these are, we should know what are the beneficial microbes that are induced. What are the pathogenic microbes, whether they are enhanced or suppressed. We have to generate data on this. Though it looks simple, every day we recommend, every time mulching is for all the tree crops, we recommend mulch. But this kind of things we have to look into a little bit deeper, so that this helps both production and protection technology. Any selective mulches, for example, brassica crops or any other things, very selective mulches is needed. That also, because we use whatever biomass available in and around, other than the main crop, we use them as a mulch. But still we can make it. This kind of mulch is going to conserve moisture as well as the conserve the beneficial microorganism, thereby useful to the control of the pest or disease. Again, weeding and farm hygiene. It is also very simple. See, weeds harbor harmful or beneficial microorganisms, everybody know. As a collateral host, it may harbor some insects, or it may harbor some pathogenic microbes. There is also no tillage with clean cultivation, especially in coconuts. Now in Pollachi and other area, they say that you don't weed it. There is no need to weed. Why do we spend more money on that? I think Dr. Ratana will appreciate this issue. And some people ask, why we should not weed it? Zero cultivation, zero tilling. But what happens to the microbes which are present there? If you maintain zero tilling, whether the beneficial organisms gets multiplied, or the harmful pathogens are getting suppressed, all this information we are not having. See, in noni crop, this kind of thing, we have lot of weeds. Again, we blow it. What happens to all those things? What it really does to the microorganism, which are the key agents to manage both the disease and also to produce or the enhancing the growth of the plant. These aspects must be looked into very carefully. The dynamics of the microbial population in the rhizosphere of orchard crops in the long run, either the no tillage or weeding, whatever it is, or the harmful effects of the clean cultivation. Suppose we remove all those things, is it harmful? How it is going to be harmful? Is it because of the reduction of the microbes or due to any other reason? All this information will go a long way in developing a very foolproof technology, both production and protection. the exploiting allelopathy is yet another area. You may be knowing that parthenia was one of the major problem, and in US Bangalore, Dr. Mahadevappa was developing an allelopathy, cassia. They were using cassia. Wherever cassia is grown, I forgot the name of the species, and the parthenium growth is not there. How? It was due to allelopathic. That means a root secreted by, root exudates secreted by cassia is harmful to the germination of the parthenium weeds. So that we call it allelopathy. It is there. Any crop, not all the crops, intercrop you suggest it may be compatible. So we go only in the terms of yield and other things. There are other aspects, intricate aspects. See, allelopathy means the ability of an organism to produce chemicals that are toxic to other organisms. For example, marigold, we recommend as a trap crop. The roots releases, this is the chemical responsible, alpha-retinyl compound. This is the most important chemical responsible for suppressing nematodes and including insects, sometimes virus disease also, they say it is controlled. So whenever we recommend such crops, either inter or mulching or cover crop, we should look into these aspects, which will be more useful. So coming to the defense of the plant, just to, this is already known. Anybody would like to defend any enemy. It may be a pathogen or a human being or animal, whatever it is, it's the nature. The plant also has such a defense mechanism. So there will not be any relationship between the pathogen and the microbes. That means we say it's a non-host. Microbes, pathogen will be there. It may not affect the host. Pathogen also plant also don't bother about it. That means a favorable environment is not existing. So we say it's non-host. And it may be a plant is antagonistic to pathogen sometimes. So the plant secretes certain chemicals so that it doesn't allow the pathogen. Then likewise, the vice versa. Pathogen is antagonistic to the plant, which is happening more at time. Often we end up with a disease or pest. Then there may be a mutualism between the plant and pathogen. They coexist. And the mutual adjustment between plant and pathogen, we say endophytic microbes. For example, mildews, powdery mildew or downy mildew, we don't see the plants dying, but still they survive. Likewise, no plant is devoid of an endophytic microorganism. What it does inside? Several plants harbor specific microorganism, including a beneficial or harmful. That means they are inside the plant. Endophyte means the microbes which are inside the plant. So they are doing wonderful. Recently, you might have seen in the paper, our alimentary system has several microbes, everybody knows. But scientists have come out to find an antibiotic which are very efficient than the available one in the market. So inside our own system, we have good things. Like that, we have to look into our own system, our own soil, to find out whether it is beneficial or harmful. Sometimes, we say crosstalk. Of course, we know the crosstalk over phone or other thing. Plants also do that. What it means really, it is sometimes the resistance is induced against a particular pathogen, maybe induced by a herbivore or vice versa. For example, in crop like tomato, when the insect pest, when we do something to manage the Helicoverpa, the pathogen Pseudomonas syringae is suppressed. So this is what I call in a scientific term, crosstalk. Then trade-off. Sometimes we apply some chemical, for example, salicylic acid induces some resistance, but the jasminic acid, see, the defense mechanism, there are several pathways of chemicals. We need not go into very elaborately into that. But when we see that this mechanism is induced, maybe another mechanism suppressed. So we have to be very critical. If both are working, maybe it is more beneficial. Whether such kind of trade-off is there, we have to see. So we have to explore a signaling. We know the conflicts between two signal molecules, then synergies in plant herbivore plant pathogen interaction. So this is what, the biotechnologists will understand more about it and they may look differently in this angle. But then realize the full potential of inducible resistance strategies in pest management program. And this is just to show what happens. So when a caterpillar just eats the plant, several things happen. We just see a caterpillar eating the plant. It is not like that. Plant responds quickly. See, several volatile compounds are produced, and through that, these are the pathways. The jasminic acid pathway. Finally, the proteinase is released or inhibitory to several of the pests. This is a, we are not going very deep into it, but we, what we want to say, the plant quickly responds. What kind of response it does, and whether such response can be profitably exploited to manage the crop. That's very important. Likewise, when the pest attacks, sometimes a systemic volatile compounds are released. The entire system of the plant gets the compounds, and the pests are ward off. They are driven away. So these are all some of the mechanism biotechnologists will be knowing more, but these are all areas where we can look. Induction of resistance, whether it is going to be beneficial for both pest and disease. That's what we have to look into it. That's the synergy we have to see. Whether we can exploit such a cross resistance, the induced systemic resistance is one of the several mechanisms that may be mobilized to counteract pest and diseases. They intervene with ISR, triggering PGP, or especially plant growth promoting rhizobacteria. They say it is triggers the growth and other mechanisms, whether we can integrate and develop a method. So ultimately now, almost I'm coming to the closer of my talk. So now we talk about the biological control agents. So look for the native rhizosphere so that there are and phyllosphere. Yesterday also they were presenting, Dr. Madhivanan was presenting the phyllosphere, phylloplane organisms. They are not simply sitting there. They are doing some job, beneficial to the plant as well as beneficial to itself. So that we have to exploit, what it does really, whether it is going to do something good for the plant, that kind of thing. We have to exploit the antagonistic potential of the such kind of things. Then PGPR that can induce cross resistance. To herbivores as well as, for example, nematodes. When Pseudomonas is used for control of several of the root pathogens, incidentally, nematode, root knot nematode is also controlled. Reports are there. Then we have to improve or modify the screening strategies. So youngsters should understand that there are several techniques. Normally we go for petri plates. We plate it and do both bacteria and fungus. We keep one pathogen and antagonist, we see some zones, immediately we jump into a conclusion that it is antagonist. But whether such mechanism works in the field, we have to see, because the microbes are empowered with so many weapons, not only antibiotics, competition, so many things are there. Whether such kind of organism we are able to isolate, we should not miss them due to our improper screening technique. The knowledge on the ecology of the biocontrol strains employed and the pathogens. See, we must understand the soil ecology. It lives in the soil or it lives on the phyllosphere or phylloplane. What is the ecology? In the long run, as the plant grows, what really happens to the population of these beneficial organisms? This is very important. Then the crops and the stage specific. See, sometimes some of the biocontrol agents may be very effective in the seedling stage, but it may fail to manage the disease at the later stage. So crop-specific and stage-specific, where we have to look such things, and the optimization of carriers and stickers in the formulation. That's also very important. And developing need-based microbial consortia. Now we talk about consortia to manage several pest diseases. So we talk about consortia which will manage both a crop as well as the pest and disease. That should be there. The knowledge and skill on the production and delivery of PCA. Basic studies to understand the mechanism behind the cross resistance to multiple pests and diseases, including nematodes, should be understood. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Love you.